Welcome to this QF test video presenting the new features of the latest major release version 4.1. Version 4.1 comes with lots of improvements in nearly all areas of QF test, like an extended support for testing web browsers, or for enhancements of testing Java applications, or even for updates to the QF test UI itself. So let's walk through those areas step by step now. Let's begin with the improvements of supporting web testing with QF Test version 4.1. One of the main features of QF Test version 4.1 was the enhancement of supporting lots of new browsers with that new QF Test version. So what have we done? We have renamed the embedding browser mode, which was known by earlier QF Test versions, to QF Driver. So that's the QF Driver mode now. And this mode has been enhanced to support 64-bit browsers as well. You can use that mode to test Internet Explorer, to test Firefox versions older than version 43, or to test Google Chrome, which is provided by QF Test. Any newer browsers can now be tested using the newly introduced WebDriver mode to QF Test. The WebDriver mode implements the WebDriver protocol provided by lots of browsers, and you can use that guy for Microsoft Edge testing on Windows. You can use it for the Safari browser testing on Mac systems, or you can use it to test the latest Google Chrome or Firefox versions on any supported operating system. So, how does using the WebDriver mode look like in QF Test? In the end of the day, it looks pretty the same like using QF Driver. The only difference is that you start the real browser window, what we can see here. So in my case, we have started the latest Firefox installation, showing up the QF Test webcar configurator demo, which is provided by the QF Test installation. So you see the real browser window and then you see the web page. If you would like to record steps, it's more or less the same as you are used from QF Driver. You press on start recording, you perform steps like opening the vehicles dialog using options vehicles and closing it, saying cancel. Once you stop the recording, you get a newly sequence recorded containing all the steps which you have performed. If you would like to replay them, you select the sequence, the steps have been replayed. So let me just do that once again, just that you take a look at the web page. Here you see the dialog appearing and being closed again, which is the consequence of our recording. So what else does WebDriver bring to QF Test, and what else can we use of that? Besides the support of new browsers like Microsoft Edge or the latest Firefox versions, we can also make use of WebDriver mechanisms in scripts. So QF Test introduced WebDriver modules to Jython or to Groovy, and utilizing those modules allows you to create a WebDriver object, what we can see here, and from that WebDriver object we can call certain WebDriver methods which we are used, or perhaps which you are used from other tools implementing the WebDriver protocol. Here in my case we see something which is determining or finding an object using the findElement method, using a bilocator to identify components by class names. Of course, it's also possible to identify components by text there or by XPath and so on. As we are using WebDriver, we could also call WebDriver actions like clicks or setting the text or something like this. Nevertheless, QF Test recommends to use the traditional QF Test mouse clicks, which, because those QF Test clicks really have a check for the existence of components, they have a check for the enabled state of components, so there is much more behind such a click than just a pure mouse click. So besides those WebDriver parts, QF Test also enhanced the ways of identifying components, which is also supported in the traditional QF Driver mode, so you can also use that in the Internet Explorer versions and so on. And QF Test introduced the component identification by three ways. You have the way of XPath identification, of CSS selector identification, and of QPath identification. Der XPath Identification is something which is again well known by users of other tools perhaps or of the WebDriver protocol, and you can now use that XPath like this in any mouse clicks or in any event nodes to identify specific HTML objects which cannot simply be recorded by QFTest in the Windows and Components tree, for instance. Besides identifying components with that particular syntax, you can also use the XPath identification in scripting, like we can see here. So we have something like node get by XPath. So the XPath mode is something which is well known to web testers in lots of areas and very, very popular. And another very popular way of identifying components for web testing is the way of identifying components by so-called CSS selectors. And we also introduced that way, so you can see that you can make use of that particular syntax here, add colon CSS equals something. This is identifying n component by those particular CSS values. Of course, you can also make use of that in SCT scripts. There is another method called get by CSS. XPath and CSS are ways which are popular in web testing, also if you use other tools like QFTest. But in addition to those popular ways, QFTest also extended the way of identifying components with the means of QFTest, and that's the so-called QPath. And there you can see that you can now identify components by QFTest, as you know from recording, and then you specify at colon, and then you can specify any arbitrary class name or tag name of HTML objects to identify an object. So in my case, I click on the first span object, which is somewhere inside that panel. Or in the second case, we can see we click on the fifth span object, which is somewhere inside that panel. So in most cases, it might be sufficient to identify components by that particular QPath instead of thinking about very complicated XPath or CSS selectors. What you can also see here, so there is a difference, and QPath might be simpler in most cases. But of course, if you have the use case and if you have the need to use XPath and CSS selectors, you can make use of them, like we can see here. We have seen that we can use XPath and CSS in scripting. We have also seen that we can make use of WebDriver objects in scripts. And in addition to that, QFTest also enhanced the DOM node API, which is used to call specific methods on web objects. So perhaps you know that we can access web objects by rc-get-component, and if you store the variable in a variable called node, you can then call the QFTest DOM node API methods. And there we have a couple of new methods introduced, like get elements by class name to identify any child component or component somewhere inside that particular HTML part by a dedicated, in this case, it's a tag name of HTML, but you could also specify QFTest classes there. And then you get a list of objects and you can do something there. Which methods we have introduced can be seen in the auto-completion list. So if you type node dot and then you type control blank or control space, you can then see all the official methods provided by that API, and you can see methods like find common ancestor, like get all by CSS, like get all by XPath, like get ancestor of class, and all of those methods are pretty new and they have been introduced to QFTest version 4.1. So it's always worth to take a look at that list so that you can see lots of useful methods there. Of course, you can also find the description of the respective method in the QFTest manual in the according chapter. Last but not least, we also extended or improved the way how to check attributes. And therefore, we made an improvement to the check text node. So in QFTest version 4.0, it was already possible to record a check text for a particular attribute like the class, like the ID attribute. But if you wanted to test a custom attribute, it was not possible to write something like custom attribute name here. This wasn't supported, Now in QF test version 4.1, this support has been introduced, and this works like this, that you specify the check type identifier to, and set it to something like attribute colon. So you would like to check an attribute, which attribute, in my case, the class attribute. Or in the next sample, you see, we want to check the attribute on click for that particular value. And you can really specify any arbitrary attribute name there, whatever you need to test. And those were the most important enhancements to web testing, a very, very important area to QF test. And now let's take a look at other enhancements. The enhancements of Java testing were that we have implemented a new way to connect from QF test to Java applications, especially for Java FX and for Java Swing applications. And this makes testing applications and especially building connections to Java applications more stable and reliable. That's especially important if you do tests for Java Web Start applications. Besides this, testing of those technologies is officially supported on macOS now. We had also reworked our UI in order to support the default key shortcuts or keyboard shortcuts of macOS. So you can use QF test using the default macOS shortcuts if you work on Mac. So what else has been improved to the QF test UI? What you can see immediately, there was one new UI button introduced to our toolbar. And this is the toolbar button to open the latest one log. So there is no need anymore to remember the Control L shortcut. So you just simply press there and you get the latest log opened. And besides that, there was one more interesting feature which has been introduced to any kind of chooser dialogues, like the procedure chooser, like the component chooser. So if you call a procedure, for instance, you are now able to search via a filter box for certain methods where you just know the name. Then you simply pick this and that's it. So those were the most important enhancements to the UI. The area of test execution got also lots of new powerful features, like the execution timeout, which has been introduced to test cases, to test steps, to test sets, to test suite nodes, as well as to the batch call. So it's now possible to specify an execution timeout. And once this timeout exceeds, the test execution is being stopped. And you will get notified in the run log that the test case took that too long. Besides the execution timeout, there is also a second very powerful feature which has been introduced, and this is the feature of rerunning failing tests. So the first part of that feature is that you can rerun failing tests directly from the run log. So you open a run log containing an error which you would like to retest, then you open the context menu. You select the rerun test cases area, then you choose the test cases which you would like to rerun, and then you select rerun the selected nodes, and those step is being executed, and you can even choose how to handle that new result via merging it into the existing results, replacing the previous ones. Besides that manual rerun, which you have to trigger by the log file, it's also possible to immediately configure a sequence or a mouse click or a test case to rerun itself once it's failing. So that's especially important if you have some kind of volatile testing, and therefore you can specify some kind of a doc tag. You can find the detailed description of those doc tags in the manual again. We have also upgraded Chitin to version 2.7, which comes with lots of improvements, especially regarding remote calls like HTTP requests and so on. We also upgraded Groovy to version 2.4.8. And besides the scripting languages, we created lots of new chapters in our manual. Especially important to know is the new section of keyword-driven testing, which describes how to set up a project for keyword-driven testing, as well as how to set up a project of behavior-driven testing. Besides the manual chapter, you can also find demo test suites in the installation folder of QFTest. And there is a second chapter being introduced, which describes how to set up a load testing project in QFTest. You can also find that chapter in the manual, as well as demo test suites in the installation folder of QFTest. The QFS standard library, the QFS QFT, got lots of new features, procedures, of course, especially procedures dealing with locales of date and time methods like getDate. Now you can specify a locale there. You can also specify locales if you would like to compare dates. And there were a couple of procedures being introduced dealing with tree nodes for FX, Swing, or SWT applications. And one important and really cool features for developers using Eclipse is that QFTest comes with an Eclipse plugin now, which allows you to integrate QFTest to Eclipse, and you are able to launch QFTest from an Eclipse installation now, and you can directly use the application which you develop within Eclipse. Let me show you how this looks like. So once you have your Eclipse and you have your application and your demo project there, then you can open the launch configurations, and there you get the QFTest launch configuration where you can specify which QFTest you would like to use, and then you can launch your application and directly connect to that application launched from Eclipse using the latest state of the source code. You can find a description how to set up and how to configure this plugin in the QFTest manual. And there are even more interesting features provided by QFTest version 4.1. For instance, we have reworked the way how to register resolvers. So now calling those add name resolver methods and so on has been improved and has even been simplified. We have extended the custom web resolver API if you extend QFTest to your custom Ajax framework. We have implemented the support of the CanDo web UI toolkit. We have upgraded the Vardin resolvers. We even upgraded some batch parameters in order to merge run logs or to specify the timeout parameter for a test run. There is an official license server which you could set up in your project, especially if you have distributed sites working on your tests. Therefore, please contact our sales team if you are interested in those license server mechanisms. And there are even simpler or smaller enhancements like a standalone data driver node, which can be used to read property nodes, or in highlighting certain steps by the context menu, and even enhancements for the debugger. So take your time, and whenever you have feedback which you would like to share with us, share it. Then please let us know and send it to qfs@qfs.de. So you can download the latest version from the QFS webpage www.qfs.de. It's worth to give it a try. Thank you for listening.